लेट्स स्टार्ट डॉक्टर सुरेश।
हेलो, एम आई ऑडिबल?
या यू आर।
सो टेक्निकल ग्लिचेस। शैल आई गो अहेड?
Yeah, please start.
Good evening, everyone. I am Dr. Suresh Chand. I am Assistant Professor in Department of Pediatric Orthopedics, KGMU, Lucknow. So I'll be talking on the topic of polytrauma stabilization in emergency. So I'll be presenting a pediatric orthopedic perspective because the ABCD of resuscitation we all have been reading since our undergraduate days. So I'll be presenting this in an pediatric orthopedic perspective. So we all remember this picture from the famous newspaper, The Guardian, which was an event happening around 4 or 5 years ago. This is a child from Syrian bomb blast victim. The child is, hello.
The picture is not visible.
Screen is not visible.
Only screen is the terrain with a tree in it. I think your screen paper or something.
Okay.
The presentation is not visible.
My screen is visible.
Your screen and your icon, the icon which you are moving. Let's start.
Yeah. Okay. So, good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Suresh Chand. I'm Assistant Professor in Department of Pediatric Orthopedics, Lucknow. So, I'll be presenting my talk on polytrauma stabilization in a pediatric emergency with a pediatric orthopedic perspective. As I believe, we have been reading the ABCD of resuscitation since our undergraduate days. So I'll be presenting a perspective from pediatric orthopedic point of view for the resuscitation and polytrauma stabilization. So we remember this picture from The Guardian that was published 4 or 5 years ago. Here we can see a child which is probably multiple trauma and is probably a polytrauma case. And he is completely shocked and he is confused. So such a scenario is common in a pediatric emergency, and we have to deal it in a different way compared to the adult emergency. So what makes a child different from an adult? That's we will discuss in this talk. And if such a scenario comes in a emergency where the leg is completely wounded and it is open and it is continuously bleeding and the child is crying all around, so how do we respond to this? Do we change our treatment protocol? Does it distract the trauma team? So a failure to secure a compromised airway and to support breathing and ventilation and to recognize the intra and cranial and intra-abdominal hemorrhage, these all things lead to unsuccessful resuscitation in any pediatric polytrauma case. So we should not change our protocol, should not distract our emergency team, and we should always follow the pediatric ALS and ATLS guidelines. All the ATLS principle can lead to improved outcome and survival in case of a polytrauma child. So how is it a child different from any adult? In case of pediatric patients, multi-system injury is rather a rule than an exception. So always suspect a multi-system injury unless proven otherwise. Because we have blunt mechanism of injuries in pediatric cases, and there are certain physiological and anatomical differences in a child which make him different from any adult patient. Apnea, hypoventilation, and hypoxia, they are more common in children compared to the hypovolemia and hypotension, which are more common in adult polytrauma cases. So we have to be aggressive in the management of airway and breathing while treating a pediatric polytrauma case. The size, shape, and surface area of pediatric body is different from the adult. The body of a child has very low amount of fat and the soft tissue around for the protection of skeletal structure is less, and all the organs are in close proximity to the skin and the outer structure. So whenever a trauma happens, a great amount of force is transmitted to per unit body area, leading to more blunt trauma and organ injuries compared to adult patient. And the child head is proportionately large compared to the body when we compare it with the adult. So there are more frequency of blunt brain injuries as well as the high cervical spine injuries. Because the surface area of child body is high compared to the adult patient, so there are chances of heat loss from body. So we have to keep hypothermia also in our mind while we are resuscitating the pediatric polytrauma case. So while resuscitation is being done, the very common mistake or pitfall is using the incorrect doses of fluids or medications in the child, especially in the centers where they are regularly, the trauma team is regularly attending the adult patient. So always calibrate your doses and adjust them according to the child, and try to get all the charts available and calculate the doses accordingly. And hypothermia is common, as we discussed, because of heat loss from the surface area of the body. So keep the temperature of emergency room in such a way it supports the child. The benefit of child and survival of child is more important than the comfort of the trauma team. So it should be a little warm and favorable for the child coming to a polytrauma. The skeleton of a child is immature. It is mostly uncalcified. There are multiple growth centers, and because of immature skeleton, it is more pliable. So it tends to bend, or there are mostly green stick fractures or plastic deformities rather than having a frank fracture like in adult. So it transmits more forces to the internal organs rather than taking all the impact on the skeleton. So there are more chances of internal organ injuries in case of a pediatric emergency polytrauma. Similarly, the psychological response of child under the trauma or in case of any accident or fall is different from the adult. They try to be in a regressive behavior, and they don't want to be poked while they are suffering the injury. So it's difficult to take the history and interact with them, and it needs physicians' effort to make a rapport. And sometimes presence of parents or caregiver themselves in the emergency team in the emergency area while resuscitation might be important to get all the necessary history and all the details regarding the injury. So a rapport making might be very important in a pediatric case. And apart from all these things, we have to consider the long-term effects of injury in case of a child. It might affect subsequent growth of the long bones, or the total height might be affected if the growth centers or the growth plates are affected. And due to trauma, some form of PTSD can also be there. So there are a lot of immediate as well as long-term consequences of polytrauma in case of a child. So when with all these differences regarding the pediatric patient in the backdrop, we come to primary survey, which is again ABCD, and which is very similar to an adult patient. There are few differences while we are doing a primary survey in the pediatric case. As we have discussed, the head of the pediatric patient is large compared to the body. So when we put the child in the spine board, by transferring or in the pediatric emergency bed, the patient is lying on bed. Because of large head, the neck is in the flex position. So the airways is not in a favorable position. It is somewhat obstructed by natural anatomical makeup of the large head. So we have to correct it by putting a 1-inch roll below the trunk and elevate it so that line of the plane of face is parallel to the spine board or the bed. So that's how we have to align the airway. So putting or the clearing the airway is first priority in the pediatric ABC. So while the primary survey is continuing through the breathing and ventilation, we have to keep in mind that respiratory rate in children is different for different age. So it's not 15 to 20 respiratory rate per minute, which is seen in adult, it's not like that. Children have a higher respiratory rate and it is different for each age segment. So we have to keep that in mind. And while we are doing assisted or mechanical ventilation, we have to keep the respiratory rate in mind. Other than that, before attempting any mechanical airway establishment, always pre-oxygenate the child. And in adult cases, we generally put the intubation, the mechanical airway in a reverse way, then we turn it and put it forward. So rotating that airway is not favored in children because it might cause injury to oropharynx and it might further obstruct the airway. The other thing is orotracheal intubation under direct vision is preferred along with the cervical spine stabilization. So nasotracheal intubation is to be avoided in children, and it is difficult as well as it leads to more soft tissue injuries and further inflammation and bleeding, which might be deleterious in the trauma situation. Now coming to primary survey of circulation and hemorrhage control, check for auscultate for heart sounds, check for femoral artery pulses and peripheral osseotibial artery and anterior artery or dorsalis pedis. Look for cold, clammy peripheries or paleness of the extremities that might suggest toward the circulatory status of child. And we have to get a venous access immediately in child to put up necessary fluids. So preferred sites are peripheral veins like antecubital fossa or the saphenous vein in the legs. And in the trauma situation, if two attempts of getting IV access are failed, we should proceed to next step. Taking a venous cut down is a time-taking procedure, and it generally takes 5 to 10 minutes. So we don't have that much of time in emergency. So in case of children, we can directly proceed to intraosseous placement of venous access, because doing a cut down takes more time, and putting a central or peripheral line through femoral vein again takes time. So in the trauma situation, if two genuine attempts of getting IV access to peripheral veins is failed, we should immediately proceed to intraosseous access of IV fluids. So a sterile disposable IO needle is what is needed. And the most common site used is the proximal tibia. And it is the location is just below and behind the tibial tubosity. And it should be placed away from the growth plate so that we do not injure the growth plate. So we have to put a sterile disposable IO needle. Size can be according to age. And all this procedure should be done in the aseptic precautions. So that's how we get intraosseous access to in case of failed IV access. This chart shows the impact of blood loss in case of a child, because they have a high physiological reserve. So in spite of losing a large amount of blood, it might not be visible, frankly, compared to the adults. So in case of about 30% blood loss, the child might have a normal systolic blood pressure, or he might have normal pulse pressure. So always look at the heart rate. If there is tachycardia, it suggests that there is some blood loss. Or maybe look at the peripheral skin, if it is cold and the capillary refill is not that much, or if the child is agitated and anxious and irritable, that suggests that there is some blood loss. Because child has a large amount of physiological reserve, so we should always suspect blood loss in the emergency. And we should be prepared to replace that and replenish that. To replenish IV fluids and the body volume, we should know the body weight and circulating blood volume. We can ask that from the caregiver or the parent if available. Otherwise, we can take estimate from the age-appropriate formulas are there, or we can use a tape, the Barslow tape, measuring tape is available with the appropriate length and weight recommendation. So we should always try to calculate exact amount of weight and circulating volume to calibrate our dosing as well as required necessary IV supplementations. Previously, there was the ATLS itself gave the guideline that the isotonic crystalloid is given initially at the rate of 20 ml per kg, followed by additional one or two boluses, depending on the response of the child. And if there is no improvement, even after 2-3 crystalloid boluses, then a packed red blood cell of 10 ml per kg used to be advised. Recently, there is a concept of damage control resuscitation, that is DCR. So they now recommend restrictive use of crystalloids. They recommend early use of packed red blood cells, fresh frozen plasma, as well as the platelets. So the natural products should be supplemented rather than crystalloids, as per the newest recommendations. These all are recommended to avoid the lethal triad of hypothermia, acidosis, as well as trauma-induced coagulopathy. So in the concept of the damage control resuscitation, that is DCR, they recommend a balanced transfusion of packed red blood cells, plasma, as well as platelets. All these three in the ratio of 1:1:1. So this is the latest guideline regarding the blood transfusion and the fluid replacement. However, practical scenarios, we don't have access to such a blood bank which can provide all the products in the readily available form. So for facilities without ready access to blood products, it has been recommended that initial crystalloid resuscitation is an acceptable thing. But after single bolus and after maybe two boluses, our blood bank might be ready with all the necessary products. Then we can switch over to DCR. So depending on the available resources and the availability of products, we can do the DCR or the crystalloid resuscitation. But the concept of DCR should always be there, and the 1:1:1 ratio should be kept in mind. So this is a summary of hemodynamic stabilization in the primary survey. So if there is issue of the circulatory or hemodynamics, we can proceed with the primary survey and necessary transition can be done. And if there is any issue with hemodynamics, the crystalloid resuscitation can be started, then move on to blood resuscitation and so on. So after we have discussed the circulatory issues, I wish to talk about the musculoskeletal examination. And so in a trauma situation, in a real life situation, we never go like A, B, C, D, E. All the things are happening simultaneously. It is a team work, and one person is doing maybe one thing and the team leader is instructing for other thing. So it might be a real life scenario that all the things are being done simultaneously. So when we look at the musculoskeletal examination, do a full exposure of a child. If there are clothes, just cut them out. And if there are wet clothes or if there is any chemical or any poisonous material around the body, just remove everything and keep a look, have an eye on all the extremities and trunk as well as head and neck. Keep in mind that there might be heat loss, so the temperature of emergency room is maintained in such a way. After exposure and proper survey, just cover the child with a warm blanket or anything like that to avoid heat loss. While examining the extremities, examine all the four limbs, the both upper limb and lower limbs. Try to look for any obvious deformity, any abnormal posture suggestive of any fracture or joint dislocation. Try to look for any open injury, bleeding wound, or any traumatic amputation. Check for pulses in vicinity of open fractures or deformity. Like if there is a forearm fracture, look for the distal radial pulses. If there is tibia or both bone leg fracture, look for the ATA, PTA, or dorsalis pedis artery, and like that. And always beware of compartment syndrome, which is very common in case of crush injuries and polytrauma cases. Assess the pain. It might give idea about any trauma in the musculoskeletal system. If there is any swelling, deformity, like we discussed in the case of fracture or joint dislocations. If there is any abnormal mobility or crepitus that is suggestive of any fracture or dislocation. If there are any swollen joints, or there is rapidly growing hemarthrosis suggestive of ligament or torn ligaments inside the joints. These all point towards musculoskeletal injuries. This is again a classical classification of open fractures. In this, the type 3C is where there is open fracture along with the neurovascular injuries requiring urgent attention of the vascular surgeon. So the type 3C is very emergent thing, and the appropriate team should be called upon and they should be informed regarding such patients. So this also comes under musculoskeletal examination. So during primary survey, recognize and control hemorrhage from musculoskeletal injuries apart from the intra-abdominal bleeds. The sources of bleed might be from any major arterial hemorrhage because of direct laceration or injury to artery. If there are femoral or pelvic fractures, there can be intracompartmental bleed leading to blood loss and shock. And in case of crush syndromes, again, there might be shock and hemorrhage. So these form of major arterial bleeds are life-threatening, and they might be due to penetrating extremity wounds, fracture and joint dislocations in and around the artery region, and the compound or open fractures and the traumatic amputations. There will be clearly visible active external bleeding from the extremity if there is any loss of previously palpable pulse, or if there is cold, pale and pulseless extremity, and if there is rapidly expanding hematoma. These all suggest there is a active bleeding going on and we should be actively managing that. So how do we manage any active bleeds from the any extremity or wound? We have to put manual pressure over the wound, try to take any sterile gauze or anything available. If sterile gauze or dressing is available, that is preferable. Otherwise, any cloth can be used for pressing the wound. And to focus our pressure over the bleeding area, we can put a stack of gauze over the wound and put a circumferential elastic bandage or a crepe bandage or any bandage, cotton bandage around to put more pressure over that area. If this also doesn't stop bleeding, try to press the artery from the proximal aspect. Like if there is a bleeding wound over the thigh region, we can put pressure over the femoral artery region and try to control the bleeding. If all these mechanisms fail, we might have to use the tourniquet. A tourniquet can be anything. A BP cuff can also be used as tourniquet, or any elastic thing can be used as tourniquet. And in the rare and outdoor scenarios, any rope or belt can be used in desperate situations. But otherwise, a tourniquet or a BP cuff is a preferable thing, and it should be applied high up so that it stops the all the bleeding. The pressure should be more than arteries to occlude all the active bleeding. Occluding only venous flow will aggravate the bleeding, and it will lead to venous congestion and swelling in the distal area. So the pressure should be more than arterial pressure in the tourniquet. And note down the timing and put the label over the tourniquet that this was applied at this time, so that the next team or wherever we are sending it to higher center or maybe in operation theater, they should know when was the tourniquet was applied. In case where the use of tourniquet was considered, it should be actively transferred to the higher team or trauma center. If there is tourniquet time more than 1 hour, then there is a scenario of life versus limb, and most probably patient is going to lose the limb. So that scenario should also be kept in mind, and we should not open the tourniquet after long time of application, because it will give all the crushed products or the washed products to the body, and there might be chances of acute renal failure or acute kidney injury because of rhabdomyolysis and all the things. So if the tourniquet has been placed for more than 1 or 2 hours, it should be kept in place, and the appropriate specialist or surgeons or orthopedician should be consulted for that. Wasting time in angiography or arteriography is not advisable in the emergency scenario, because they are time taking, and the unnecessary precious time is wasted on these investigations. These are recommended for all the resuscitated, successfully resuscitated patients who are stable to be shifted to CT or NGO room. And that's how we proceed in emergency room. Whenever there is a doubt of vascular injury, call the vascular colleague or CQVS or a plastic colleague for the help. And in case of open wounds, clamping the vessels with the arteries or any clamp is not advisable because it is not possible sometimes to do that, and it wastes our precious time and it further damages the vessel, which might hamper our chances of repairing the vessel in the later on. So always put a pressure, or if that fails, use a tourniquet. In case of open fractures, we just have to realign them and splint them and then put a pressure. Don't keep the limb in a deformed position. Try to align it gently so that the pulse comes back sometimes, or it does, the bony spicules don't further injure the surrounding tissues and neurovascular structure. So any fracture, any limb which fractured, just realign it gently and put a splint over that and apply a direct pressure. In case of joint dislocations, a gentle reduction attempt can be given, and a help of senior orthopedic colleague or an experienced trauma technician can be taken to gently reduce it. Otherwise, just splint it wherever the most comfortable position is there. Another source of acute bleeding in a trauma situation can be a traumatic amputation, which is a very devastating thing. And such scenarios may benefit from immediate application of tourniquet, like we discussed. And sometimes amputation can be life-saving in case of severe crushes or a child in a shock. A well-planned amputation can be life-saving. So we have to keep that in mind. And in case of mangled extremities or cut extremities, like a finger is cut along with all the other injuries, the potential for reimplantation should be considered. But reimplantation is not ideal for a polytrauma case requiring resuscitation. It is indicated for a single leg or single extremity fracture cases, not for polytrauma cases. Nevertheless, if there is need of, there is an option of reimplantation, put the amputated part in Ringer lactate and wash it with Ringer lactate and wrap it in the sterile gauze, cover it with most sterile towel, and put it in the plastic bag and cover it with the crushed ice, and never freeze the amputated part, and it should be transported along with the patient to the higher center, and they can take a call about the reimplantation or if there is anything they can do. Probably a polytrauma patient will not be fit for any reimplantation procedures, but whenever there is a chance of reimplantation, we should always protect the part. And this is how it should be transported along with the patient to the higher center. So all the survey should be done repeatedly, and ABCD, the primary survey of ABCD should be done multiple times to identify all the injuries. And the blood loss from musculoskeletal injury should be identified and should be addressed urgently along with all the other things going on in the trauma emergency. Another thing related to musculoskeletal injuries is compartment syndrome. Classically, compartment syndrome is defined as increased pressure in the closed osteofacial compartment. And the rough value for adult patient is increase of pressure above 30 mm of Hg. However, in case of shock and in case of children, this might not be very reliable definition. So the new definition or the more appropriate definition is having a compartment pressure more than 20 mm Hg of a diastolic pressure. So anything above that is a compartment syndrome. However, all these things are not possible. Measuring a compartment pressure is not possible in the real life trauma scenario. So there should be high index of suspicion, and any polytrauma or any multiple trauma or fracture case can have compartment syndrome. Classically, 5 P's are defined for compartment syndrome in the adult patient: having pain out of proportion, having paresthesia and tingling, having passive stress pain, pale limb with pulselessness, is the all these might be features of compartment syndrome. However, in the case of child, 3 A's have been defined: increased anxiety, increased agitation, and increased need of analgesia. All 3 A's point towards the compartment syndrome. with the backdrop of polytrauma or musculoskeletal injuries, and they should be urgently diagnosed, and a surgeon or orthopedic colleague should be immediately contacted, and probably a fasciotomy or urgent decompression might be required, which might be a limb-saving procedure in such scenarios. Apart from extremity injury, the pelvic injury can be a common source of hemorrhage and shock and unstable patient. So we should keep that in mind and should also look for that. Thankfully, because of immature and pliable skeleton, pelvic injuries are not so common compared to adults. However, we should always check for that. The diagram shows three types of pelvic injuries. In the first diagram, there is open book type of injury. In the second diagram, it is compression type of injury. In the third, it is vertical shear. So these are roughly, grossly, three types of injuries which can be presented in the emergency department. So how do we check for that? We do pelvic compression and distraction test. For compression test, we put our hands over the greater trochanter and ASIS region, and we try to compress the pelvis. If there is some play, and we can suspect that there might be pelvic injury. And in case of distraction test, we try to open the pelvis. And if there is some play, that again suggests that the pelvic ring is broken and the integrity of pelvic ring is broken and there is some pelvic injury, and we should try to stabilize that. So how do we do pelvic stabilization? We put a pelvic binder, and it is placed at the level of greater trochanter, and we tie it together. If the ready-made pelvic binder is not available, we can use anything like a tablecloth or a bed sheet or a curtain or a dupatta, anything with a appropriate length can be used as pelvic binder, and it is put at the level of greater trochanter so that all the both the pelvis come together, and there is no dislodgement of hematoma, and there is no further bleeding while we are shifting the patient or while we are resuscitating the patient. We can see in this example that in the left side x-ray, the pelvis is completely open, and we can see that pubic symphysis is far away from each other. So there is open book injury. And in the right side, we can see that after putting a pelvic binder, it has come together. So any bleeding happening inside the pelvic cavity will get a natural tamponade effect, and probably we'll get some respite from the continuous bleeding, and we might be able to save the patient. So always check for pelvis compression and distraction test during the primary survey, and if needed, put a pelvic binder and use whatever is available in the local surroundings. After musculoskeletal examination, the point of neurological examination. So doing a Glasgow Coma Scale survey during primary survey will give idea about the motor activity of the patient. It will give idea, rough idea about brain injury as well as spine injury. And anyway, we always suspect the cervical spine injury, and cervical collar or Philadelphia collar is always put in a polytrauma child. So Glasgow Coma Scale can be a rough guide towards that. This is the difference between pediatric and adult Glasgow Coma Scale. The points are almost same, but we have to change a few things according to the patient. Like there are different things or articles or points to be noted in the child as well as in infant. Like for verbal response, an infant will not obviously respond to your command. So we have to look for coos and babbles, or we have to judge from the cries or the response of patient towards the any painful stimulus. Similarly, a child or infant will not be able to follow your command. So we have to look at the activity of child. So that's how we do pediatric GCS. Or anything below 8 suggests any brain injury or any spinal injury leading to decreased motor response. So we can always look at the motor response even in the unconscious child or intubated child. So that's how we can get a rough idea about the neurological involvement. And in the case of secondary survey, we can again check whole of the spine, use the log roll method to turn the patient safely along with the cervical spine stabilization, check for spine tenderness from cervical to coccyx, if there is any deformity, if there is any deficit, like a limb is in an abnormal position compared to other, or the child is not moving one leg compared to other, that might suggest some deficit is there, or if there is any obvious indication of bladder wall involvement, all these point towards the spine injury, and that should be an indication for further evaluation after the secondary survey. So in this picture, it is shown how we do a log roll. This is ideally done with the four member team. One member is doing cervical spine stabilization and airway and breathing control from the head end. Other two patients, team members are at the shoulder and pelvis, as well as pelvis and leg level. And they turn the patient towards the one side at 5-1-2-3 command. And the fourth person can check the spine, can do secondary survey, and can change the bed sheet or take out the spine board. And similarly, after 1-2-3 command, it can be put back and further things can be done. So that's how a log roll protocol or log roll is done in the cervical spine or the spine injury suspected patients in polytrauma. So few things about spinal injury in children perspective. Thankfully, spinal cord injuries are very uncommon in children. And this is due to some anatomical differences, likely like that interspinous ligaments and joint capsules are more flexible in case of children. The vertebral bodies are wedge-shaped. They are like more of a trapezoid form rather than a rectangular form, even if we see it on X-ray. The facet joints are flat. And as we have discussed, children have relatively large head compared to the body. So whenever they have a trauma or any accident or motor vehicular accident, a large amount of angular momentum is generated in the head, and they have high chances of high cervical injuries compared to the adults. And due to immature skeleton, there are a number of growth plates and growth centers around the neck and head area. And all the forces transmitted are generally because the child is small compared to the forces. So per unit area, force is transmitted more in case of children compared to adults. Another thing which is quite common in children is SCORA, that is spinal cord injury without radiographic abnormalities. What it means is that when we do a radiological examining investigation, X-ray or any other investigation, it might be appearing normal. However, there are situations where a child might have a deficit or nerve or spinal cord involvement. So having a normal investigation might not be necessary that there is no injury. Always suspect spinal cord injury and use appropriate help of spinal surgeon or orthopedic surgeon to rule out spine injury in the polytrauma case. So after all these ABCD of the resuscitation with child perspective, we should proceed to secondary survey, do a complete secondary survey before moving to definitive management or shifting the child to appropriate higher level or trauma center or operation theater. Complete the secondary survey, take complete history. We should always ask for mechanism of injury and the surroundings at the wherever the injury happened or the accident happened. Always ask for pre-injury status, which is very important. Like a child of spina bifida has paraplegia of lower limbs from pre-injury level. So child is not moving legs after the trauma, which is very usual thing. So we should know what was the pre-injury status. If a child has previously deficit in the limbs, obviously he'll not move the legs after the injury. So a pre-injury status level is always should be asked and should be sought for. And full examination should include from head to toe examination, check for eyes, face, head and neck, throat and chest, look for back, look for abdomen and pelvic trauma, and do extremity survey again. And examine the perineal and perioral areas to rule out any associated injury. Another thing which is to be kept in mind while treating the pediatric polytrauma in emergency is child maltreatment. That is battered baby syndrome or a battered child. All these cases of child maltreatment have a six-fold higher mortality compared to accidental trauma. So we should have high index of suspicion and a proper history and careful examination should be done in every case of child polytrauma in emergency. How do we suspect child maltreatment or battered baby syndrome in emergency? If there is a discrepancy between history and degree of physical injury, like the parent or caregiver is saying that child was playing with siblings and child is presenting with femur fractures or both leg fractures or both arm fractures, which is difficult to believe sometimes. And if there is a delayed presentation to emergency from trauma, and if there is a history of multiple traumas being treated at different times in same or different hospitals, this again suggests that there might be some issues there and that should be looked upon. And if there is a discrepancy between the history between mother and father, mother is telling something else and father is telling something else about the cause of injury or date of injury, all these things should be pointing towards child maltreatment. And sometimes the mechanism of injury is impossible to explain the amount of injury, like a 6 month or 9 month old child having a leg fracture is very difficult to believe because child is not walking. And if any child of 6 month of age comes with a leg fracture, we should always suspect child maltreatment. And during examination, there are certain signs which favor towards the child maltreatment, like having a multicolored bruises in different stages of healing suggests that child is being beaten up or there is maltreatment. Or if there is evidence of previous injuries, like many multiple healed scars or scars or sutured wounds are there, they might also point towards child maltreatment. If there is perioral injuries or if there are injuries to genital and perianal areas, it might be pointing towards the sexual abuse in case of child, especially a girl child. Having fractures of long bones in a younger child, ruptured internal viscera without any history of major blunt trauma to body, and retinal hemorrhages, cigarette burns, bites and rope marks, and skull or rib fractures in case of young infants. These all point towards child maltreatment and they should be reported to appropriate authorities. In the Western countries, there are rules which bind physician
Dr. Suresh, your voice is not audible.
And it is our
Yeah, your voice is not audible. I believe you got disconnected in between. Please unmute yourself once again.
Sorry, so where was I? I mean,
when you're talking
hello.
About maltreatment.
Okay, so I'll go back. I'll try to continue from there. So, I'll start from again from child maltreatment. So these cases have a higher rate of mortality compared to a accidental injuries, and we should have high index of suspicion and we should always take a thorough history and careful evaluation should be done in the polytrauma case. So how do we suspect a child maltreatment or battered baby syndrome? If there is a discrepancy between history given and see that child was playing with the elder sister and he has multiple long bone fractures, so history is not matching with the injuries. Similarly, if there is delayed presentation to emergency, or if there is history of repeated trauma being treated at same or different emergencies, so that also points towards the battered baby. Syndrome or the history between and the father is giving different history, and if the parents are not very keen to follow your commands, and if they are leaving it the child unattended in the emergency, so that might be a scenario where child maltreatment has been done. Other findings which might suggest towards the child maltreatment is having a multicolored bruises. That is bruises in multiple stages of healing. They again suspect multiple episodes of maltreatment. And if there are evidence of previous injuries like healed scars or multiple previously healed fractures or deformities, injuries in the perioral injuries, injuries in genital or perianal areas, especially in a girl child. And if there are multiple long bone fractures in younger infant children, or if there is a ruptured internal viscera without any history explaining the injury. If there are retinal hemorrhages, or if there are bizarre injuries like cigarette burns, bites, or rope marks, all these things can be pointing towards the child maltreatment, and we should always suspect them, and they should be reported to appropriate authorities or social worker or child welfare department, or maybe to a nearby police station. Because if we do not report it, a child might be again subjected to maltreatment and he might lose life in the next episode. So always suspect, and we are legally bound to report it. So after this discussion of primary survey and ABCD resuscitation, emergency splinting regarding the musculoskeletal injuries is very important thing. So splint is any rigid structure which can support the limb, injured limb. Ideally it should be padded, but any rigid support can be used as splint. The function of splint is to support the injured limb, to reduce the pain, to prevent further injuries to local tissues and neurovascular structures, and to relieve swelling and inflammation in the injured part. A most commonly used splinting material in emergency department is Kramer wire, shown in this the first picture. It is an aluminium molded wire thing which is available, and it is covered with cotton and bandage so that it is well padded and not hurting the limb. And it can be folded to any area. It can be applied to upper limb or lower limb or in the ankle. So it is a reusable thing and easily available in the emergency department. Other splinting material can be plaster of Paris or fiberglass material, or any cardboard available in the surroundings, or the properly made splints, or anything like an umbrella or a newspaper or any stick can be used in the outdoor surroundings or in the injury happening in remote areas. So how do we splint the limb? One joint above and one joint below should be splinted. So if there is a forearm fracture, we should always try to mobilize the elbow as well as the wrist. So this concept is generally tried to be followed during the splinting. It should be well padded, otherwise it will cause injury and sore and further damage to soft tissue. It should not be too tight so that it doesn't hamper the neurovascular flow. Too much tight splint will hamper the neurovascular flow, and peripheral vascularity of limb will be further compromised in case of polytrauma. Always check the neurovascular status after the application of splint, and we should have a habit of doing early or so checking the distal neurovascular structure and status of the splinted limb in the emergency. There are few examples how we do femoral fracture stabilization in the emergency, a long splint or a Liston splint or any log or a plywood can be used for femur splintage. This is classical Thomas knee splint. We all so this is Thomas knee splint used for the femur fracture stabilization, and it is commonly used in an emergency scenario with along with the skin foam traction. For the leg and ankle fractures, we can use any cardboard material or maybe a Kramer wire, and if not available, we can use any log with appropriate padding. And similarly, upper limb can be splinted with anything. As far as you are following the splintage principles, you can use anything which is available in the surrounding area. So always splint the limb. The only thing is never put a traction in case of multiple fractures in the same limb. If like there is a tibia fibula fracture as well as femur fracture in the same limb, never put a traction. Otherwise, it will distract the limb and it will further damage the neurovascular injury. In such scenarios, just put a long posterior splint and just leave it at position. Just gently realign the fracture and don't try to put a traction or don't try to reduce it too much. Otherwise, it will cause neurovascular injury. And after all the things we have discussed about the resuscitation and management of the polytrauma, the highest point of concern is injury prevention. Almost 80% of childhood injuries are preventable. So the awareness part is most important thing to prevent all these injuries to happen in first place. So as a physician, we might have a job to do in creating awareness and providing some guidelines or structure guidelines to make in the hospital or school and in communities so that all these preventable injuries can be avoided and there is no need to do all these things. To summarize, we have discussed the unique characteristics of children regarding anatomy and physiology and their response to trauma and how should we treat them differently compared to adults, because ABCD resuscitation is more or less same in adults. But there are certain intricacies in pediatric population which we should keep in mind. And we also should keep this in mind that the vital sign range is different in case of children, like the respiratory rate or the blood pressure is different in children compared to adults, as well as the body weight and circulating volume is different and the blood requirements might be different compared to the adult. So all these smaller dose adjustments might be needed. And like as usual, ABCD approach to be followed during primary and secondary surveys. And in case of multiple organ injuries or extremity injuries, always try to involve the general surgeon or pediatric orthopedic surgeon. And suspect child maltreatment in case of polytrauma patient. And all the time, we should try to create awareness in our community and the surroundings to prevent all the injuries, and as a physician, we should try to spread the awareness to all these preventable things. Thank you so much.
Very calm and composed presentation, Dr. Suresh.
Yeah,
although there were some glitches, but it was really well appreciated.
Sorry for those technical glitches.
That's okay, absolutely fine. It happens. Good work done, man. Very good. I think it was so elaborate. There are no questions being posted. All I've asked them to put questions, but there are no questions. And maltreatment and compartment syndrome was very nicely being kept in. It's very important for every pediatrician to understand all the 5 P's and the 5 A's which you have told about compartment syndrome, because I believe in polytrauma case, if that aspect has been taken care by a pediatrician or pediatric emergency specialist, we are going to save the limb and life as well.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Suresh. Thanks for the time.
Thank you. Thank you so much.